lot of people, so what should I expect when I go?
Oh, well, it's what we like to call it is nerd prom.
Huh? Rance was staying at my little apartment in Hollywood. I was writing this record called Little Earthquakes. It was probably about 1988, 89. It's so far back now, it's hard for me to remember all the details, but I had a boyfriend that had a place in the valley, so I'd sleep there, and then I'd work all day at my place, and then Rance would come and crash. So he had all this stuff, all kinds of comic books with him. And he would say, Tor, read this, read that. And that was the beginning of my exposure. Well, I read all of the Sandman stuff. I started, I think, with The Dollhouse, and then I read everything. And it was just one of those kinds of stories, maybe because of the mythology, that worked for me. And I didn't know how I would feel about it when Rand said, you have to read comics, because I think people get an impression of what they are based on, I don't know what your opinion's based on, but until you really dive into it and you read something that clicks for you, I don't think you haven't, you're still a comic virgin. I think it just came together. I got an email from Rance, and he had run into the guys from Image at the last Comic-Con, and they said, do you really know Tori? And he said, well, of course, we're friends. And they said, well, why don't you all pull something together? And then he sent me an email, and that was the beginning. I know it sounds really simple, but the idea was simple, but then the work, especially on his part, he was so incredibly and is dedicated. He was the editor, and so you could say he's captain of the ship for the creative side. I would say that my role was Rance knowing that I had his back, that I would leverage. I own the publishing for the songs, and I was going to bring my strength to the project, and there was no way that somebody was going to walk into Rance's world and say, you need to change this, or you need to change that, or this isn't going to work for our audience, maybe this demographic, because this is not just for the comic world. This was going everywhere. And yet I said, creatively, I don't want any censorship. I don't want, usually what happens to musicians is you turn in a project and then the powers that be will step in and say, you need to change this track and you need to change that track. And this happens to more records than you can imagine. It's very rare when a record will go out on a mass level that has complete and total support without some kind of changes. So I was going to make sure that there was going to be no, how would you say it, no powers that be to stop this massive release. Well, I think that there are variations on the theme, and that's how I read them. Sometimes they're very close to the pictures I get when a song comes originally, and then sometimes these stories were really far away from any picture I may have ever had. And cornflake girl with spider legs coming out of the skirts, for example. But I really, I thought that it was exciting to see variations on these songs that might be different from anything anybody's ever seen when they hear. So, of course, sometimes I was shocked about it, but I love to be shocked. I live to be shocked.
You think you can come around?
No, that it was more about, let's just open the whole music catalog to all these artists and let them choose what they want to write about. So it was never talking about Tori's image over the past 16 years. That was a surprise, but that made Rance really happy. Rance can tell you a bit better than I can, but there were times when a couple artists would want to do the same story, and he would try and talk them into doing another story if he had two for one. And he'd say, no, don't you really want to do this one? And they would say, well, no, I really have an idea for this one. But of course, you can only have one team for one story. So he did a great job, I think, in sensing, well, would you be open to maybe listening to a few? And there were those artists that did and would say, actually, I'm going to do this instead. So I think this is where his charm and his, again, I say this word, his dedication to the project. He supported the artists in a fantastic way. Every single one of them, I've spent time now with them for months, and I have to tell you that every single one of them has been reread and reread by me so many times. I think that this is a level where so many, I would read, say, Little Amsterdam, and I'd be taken to a place of darkness and relationships in the South and how I see the South. And then I would read Jackie Strength, and Jackie Strength was quite a surprise because, without giving anything away, the song never showed me this picture before, that the woman would have a gun herself. And so, story after story, I would jump around and I would get surprised all the time. You see, the order that you're seeing it now wasn't necessarily how I would be given the stories. To me, again, these are variations on the theme, not covers. And that's why when I would read some of these stories, then music would come in my head, but it wouldn't be the music that would have the title on it. So I would be, say, looking at Honey, or I would be looking at the story of the beekeeper. And those songs wouldn't come to me when I was looking at it, but different music would come. I would say that Delirium and I have stolen from each other over the years. Sometimes twice a year. I'm working on a few things right now. I think leaving Sony has been incredibly liberating. I was working on Comic Book Tattoo while I was working on trying to get out of the old record business model. There are things within the industry that have been developed over many years that are good. There's no question. I love structure when it works, but there are ways of looking at it that I find completely out of date and barbaric in a way, and not supportive of innovative creativity. A lot of times it's about how do you get the advertisers to support it, because your message doesn't rock the boat of either those big corporations, mentioning no names, that own a lot of these outlets. We're not talking about independent shops right now. They have their own, they have their own rules and laws, but when you're working through huge corporations, then you have to sometimes walk a very, you have to play a different chess game. How's that? And I'm willing to do that. I love doing that. I really love to negotiate with those guys. Sometimes they're women, but a lot of times they're guys, and sometimes they're right-wing Christians. And you have to find ways to stay true to what you believe in. And not all the time when you're working with a major label will they be brave enough to put work out that might challenge the belief system of these people. So leaving this, I've been a part of it for 22 years, and it doesn't mean that I won't work with people within the industry, but I'm looking more from an indie. I'm kind of making myself my own indie label so that I can partner with people that I think are more open-minded. Yeah, and I was happy that there were quite a few women involved. Rance and I talked about that, and we made sure that there were women approached for this, and as you can see, there are quite a few women. And I said to him, I mean, we talked about it. I said, this has to be open to not just the hottest male writers, but it has to be open to the hottest female writers as well. And he, you know, he's right there with me. He's four little girls, so Rance is a feminist.